Hi, I'm Jesús Ramirez. In this session, I'll show you how to turn your Photoshop composites into animations using Adobe Firefly. In case you don't know me, I've been a professional graphic artist for over 20 years. Most recently, I worked on creating TV and movie posters. If you'd like to see some of those projects, you can always check out my Behance page. You might also know me from the Photoshop training channel on YouTube, where I teach Photoshop to over 2 million subscribers. My training is always grounded in real-world professional production workflows, and this session is no different. In the next 15 minutes, we'll cover professional compositing techniques, how to animate images with Adobe Firefly, and how to bring those animations back into Photoshop for extra animation and enhancements with the timeline panel. I'll be moving fast, but don't worry, you can always replay the video to catch anything you missed. The goal here is to create a composite of a statue in a yoga pose. Then, I want to animate elements like fire and water around it. Let's start by looking at how I gather the assets for this project. First, I went to stock.adobe.com and downloaded this photo of a man practicing yoga. I use Adobe Stock for every movie and TV poster I work on, so I highly recommend it. And don't forget, Adobe Stock has a free tab where you can grab thousands of photos, videos, vectors, and even 3D assets at no cost. Next, I jumped into Adobe Firefly's text-to-image module, and I generated a 3D material. I asked for a gray sphere with an old weather stone surface, smoke cracks, light moss, and stains. Out of the results, this one was my favorite. Then, again in the text-to-image module, I used the man practicing yoga as my composition reference, and the 3D stone material as my style reference. With those in place, I generated a new image using the Firefly Image 4 Ultra model in this prompt. That gave me the result we'll use in this project. And finally, for the background, I downloaded another image directly from Adobe Stock. And here we are in Photoshop with the two assets in this document. The first step is to cut out the background. But before I do that, I'll right-click on the statue layer and convert it to a smart object to work non-destructively. You can edit the contents of a smart object by double-clicking on it from the Layers panel, which opens it up in a new tab. From here, I'll click on Remove Background from the Contextual Taskbar, which uses cloud processing to detect the subject and mask it out with just one click. Next, I want to make sure that my transformation handles are around the statue and not around the canvas. This will make it easier for me to transform the layer in the next step. To do so, hold Control on Windows or Command on the Mac and click on the Layer Mask thumbnail to load it as a selection. Notice the marching ants are now around the statue. Then I'll click on the crop tool and it will align to the selection. Make sure to uncheck delete crop pixels. You don't want to delete anything. And I'll apply the crop by pressing the enter or return key. Then I'll save, and in the temple document, I'll press Ctrl T on Windows, Command T on the Mac to transform, and you'll see the transformation handles only around the statue. Then I'll scale the layer and place it in the center. Now here's another trick. By default, Photoshop disables the reference point, and you can enable it by clicking on this checkbox. Then you can click on these boxes to move the reference point to any of those locations. In case you don't see it, the reference point is this icon. It determines where the layer rotates from. In this case, I want to place the statue right in the center of the circle. I'll click on this icon to move the reference point to the bottom center transformation handle. Then, when I hold Alt or Option and drag from the corner handles, I scale to that point. Now, I have to scale them into position. This works. And now, let's make the background a bit less distracting and apply a cinematic look. To do so, I'll disable the statue layer, and I'll convert the background into a smart object. Then, I'll go into the Filter menu and choose Camera Raw. This filter gives us total control of the light and color of our image. In this case, I'll simply go into Lens Blur and I'll click the Apply button. This creates a synthetic depth map and simulates a realistic camera blur. You can select from different types of bokeh presets. I'll stick to the circle. And you can control the amount of blur. 35 works in this case. Once you're happy with your blur, you need to select the areas that will remain in focus, the part below where the statue's sitting. To get that area in focus, you can enable the Point Area Focus icon and click over it. Then, you can use the Focus Range controls to increase or decrease the range of blur applied to the image. The left handle controls the foreground blur. I'll reduce it to keep it off the circle. And the handle on the right controls the blur in the background. I don't need the entire circle in focus back here, so it's okay to keep a little blur. I'll press OK to commit the changes. Next, we need to make sure the statue matches the scene. And in this new version of Photoshop, it's easier than ever. All you need to do is click on the foreground element. Then click on the brand new Harmonize button from the taskbar to use generative AI technology to add matching light, shadows, and reflections to your scene. It creates a whole composite with just one click. Photoshop will generate three variations. You can then cycle through them to find the one you like best. In this case, I'll stick with the first one. Once you have a composite you like, I recommend placing everything into a smart object to apply the final adjustments. To do so, I'll click on the topmost layer. Then I'll hold shift and click on the bottommost layer to select all the layers in between. Then I'll right click on any of the layers and choose convert to smart object. And now I can treat this composite as a single image. Next, I'll go back to our good friend, the camera raw filter, and I'm going to apply several adjustments. I'm just going to go down the list here. This is how I recommend that you edit in this panel. I'll start on top with the light panel, and from here, I'll increase the contrast to make the image pop a bit more. Then I'll darken the shadows. From the colors panel, I'll increase vibrance. This adds saturation, but in a smart way. It protects already saturated pixels and skin tones. In this case, I don't have to worry about skin tones, but I do want to prevent oversaturation. Now I'll go into the effects panel, and from here, I'll add a vignette to darken the edges around the image to focus the viewer into the statue. I will also increase the grain to prevent oversmoothing caused by lens blur. It also makes the image look more cinematic. Next, I'll go to one of my favorite features, the powerful automatic masks in Lightroom, to selectively target areas to edit. From the masks panel, I'll click on people. Photoshop will then analyze the image and recognize the statue as a person. You can then create a mask around the entire person or target specific features it identified. I'll choose entire person and click on create. Now I have a mask that only applies effects to the statue. So I'll reduce saturation. Then I'll enhance the texture, clarity, and sharpness to make it stand out. This looks great. We have a highly stylized composite that looks very cinematic, and we're ready to convert this image into video using Adobe Firefly. To do so, I'll export this image into a PNG by going into File, Export, Quick Export as a PNG, and save it anywhere you like on your device. Then open up your browser and navigate to firefly.adobe.com, where you can use various modules to generate images, audio, and video. From the navigation bar, I'll choose video. Then I'll click on image to video. This module lets you turn an image into video with a text prompt. On the left, you'll find settings to guide your generation. First, pick a model. I'll use Firefly Video Model by Adobe since it's commercially safe. You also have access to partner models to help you ideate and experiment with different results. Next, I'll choose the resolution. I recommend 540 while you're experimenting with prompts, but I'll set mine to 1080. Then you can adjust controls to help you guide the generation, such as a composition reference, shot size, camera angle, motion, and styles. In this case, we want to animate an image, so I'll click on the first frame icon. Then I'll click on your device, and I'll upload the temple.png I just saved. We can now convert this image into a video by entering a prompt. But if we also want to control how the video ends, we can add an end frame image. If we use the same image for both the start and ending points, Firefly will generate the in-between content, but the video will begin and end with the same image, creating a seamless loop. And now that we have our starting and ending frames, we no longer have access to the style controls because Firefly will use the frames to determine those settings. The challenge here is writing a good prompt. It requires some trial and error, but Adobe has a helpful guide that explains how to structure prompts for better results, and it includes a prompt formula for video. You can scan this QR code to check it out. To work a little faster, I'll paste in a prompt that will likely work. Then I'll click Generate. My prompt is telling Firefly to generate fire around the statue and to add effects like sparks and smoke. I also needed to tell Firefly to make the background torches flicker. Now, I can click on the play button to see the result. This video looks great, so I'll save it by clicking on the download button. I've already generated another version with a different prompt. I'll play it so you can see it. This version creates water. By the way, if you're not getting the results you want, make sure to try the partner models. They all have different capabilities and styles. Here's one example using Google's VO3. Also, if you want to dive deeper into Firefly, head over to adobe.com/learn/Firefly. You'll find many video tutorials, most of which I created for Adobe, that will show you how to get the most out of these generative AI features. Next, I'll take the generated videos into Photoshop to add further animations and effects. I'll start by opening the video. I'll go into File, Open, and select the first video. This will automatically open the timeline panel, and you can press the spacebar to play the video. Next, I'll enhance this video with adjustment layers and text. I'll start by creating a curves adjustment layer. Then, I'll move it out of the video group by pressing Control or Command and the right bracket key. You could, of course, drag it out instead if you like. Now we're going to use this curves adjustment layer to brighten the scene as soon as the fire ignites, right about here. To do so, I'll drag up on the curve. Then, from the red channel, I'll drag up to add red. Notice the new overlays that Photoshop displays in the curves panel. They help you determine what colors you're adding when you're dragging up or down. Then from the blue channel, I'll drag down to add yellow. This creates a bright, hot effect. But I only want this effect to apply as soon as the fire ignites. To animate the effect, I will expand the curves video layer and use these keyframes. You can think of them as presets that are activated by time. For example, I can click on the opacity keyframe stopwatch icon to create a keyframe that will record the current opacity and time. Then I'll drag the playhead to another position in time, right before the fire starts. And I'll set the opacity to 0, which will automatically create a keyframe. Then I'll move forward in time just after the fire ignites. I'll set the opacity to 0. Now, this effect is only at its maximum intensity when the fire ignites. And actually, I'm off by a few frames, and I also don't like the duration of the effect. So, I'll separate the keyframes to make the effect last longer. I'll hit play once again, and that looks much better. Next, I'll show you how to animate text. I'll enable the type tool, and I'll type the word fire. Next, I'll make the text larger and place it in the center of the frame. By the way, if you create a layer and it appears inside of the video group, the new layer will be placed after that video. See how the layer moved to the end of the video? If this happens to you, simply drag the video out of the group, and I'll drag this clip to the start of the video. If you can't see where that is, you can zoom in and out of the panel by dragging on these controls. Now, I'll drag the text layer all the way to the left, past the edge of the canvas. Then I'll expand the video to reveal the keyframes, and I'll click on the transform keyframe. I'll go to the end of the video and drag the layer to the other side. Now, when I hit play, the word fire moves across the screen, and we can take advantage of more Photoshop tools and features to create more interesting effects. For example, I can change the blending mode from normal to overlay to make the text blend with the background. I can even apply a layer mask to the animated text. To do so, I'll enable the video layer and click on Select Subject to select the statue. With the text layer active, I'll hold Alt on Windows, Option on the Mac, and I'll click on the layer mask icon to create an inverted layer mask. Now, the text will appear as if it goes behind the statue as it scrolls through the screen. It looks fantastic. Next, I'll import the second video. I'll go to File and choose Place Embedded. From here, I'll select the video. Then I'll drag this new clip to the end of the timeline so that it plays after the fire video. At this point, you can repeat the text layer process, change the text to water, and you will get a seamless animation loop with both videos. Everything looks great, and I'm ready to export this animation as a video file. To do so, go into the flyout menu and choose Render Video. From here, select H.264 and click on the Render button. We've covered a lot in 15 minutes, and I hope you picked up some new tips and techniques you can start using right away. Again, my name is Jesús Ramirez, and you can find me at the Photoshop Training Channel on YouTube. Thank you so much for joining me here at Adobe Max 2025.